Welcome, dear friends, participants. I'm pleased to welcome you to our webinar on the fascinating world of test dust. And at least for today, it's okay to talk about these tiny bits and pieces that we all want to get rid of in the common case. My name is Knut Hirsch. I'm your moderator today, giving you the introduction, and I will talk you through the Q question and answer session at the end of the webinar. My main job is marketing and communications, and here at DMT I'm leading this business. But much more important are our test dust experts, Dr. Dirk Rentschen, head of product assessment refrigeration and air quality, and Jens Frank Matiak, head of test laboratory and product manager test dust. DMT has quite a long history in manufacturing test dust, and today we are the experts for test dust and offer more than 50 different types, including test dust for environmental testing. And we distribute these across the world, so it's an international business. In this webinar, we talk about the purposes of test dust, what characteristics test dust may have, how test dust can be applied, and how it is produced. And we will also come to the typical fields of application at one point or another. But before we get started, a few words about the technical procedure of this webinar. The main communication interface in this webinar is a chat window. If you have any question or comment, please put it into the chat window. If you experience any technical problem, please put it into the mail window, chat window as well, and we should help you. If you want to be contacted by us after the webinar, please put your request with your email address into the chat window. If you would like to receive the recordings of this webinar, the presentation as such, please leave a message in the chat window. Furthermore, the webinar will be recorded while preserving your anonymity. We'll make it available as a stream to all participants, and if you like to have it, as already said, please put a message into the chat window. The Q&A session at the end of the webinar will work as follows. You are invited and encouraged to ask questions, put it in the chat, and I will collect these questions and will ask them to the experts on your behalf at the end of the presentation. Due to technical reasons, it's not possible to get these things on a live track. Okay, I think that's it so far. Let's get started, and I hand over to Dr. Dirk Rentschen.
Yes, welcome heartily to our first webinar above test dust. We just started this idea in the summer and tried to make our very best in preparing the presentation you will see in a few seconds. And so I hope the things we want to clarify within this webinar, how we produce test dust, what is the sense of test dust, and something about quality control and all these things will be quite clear for you. But if there are still questions left, as Knut Hirsch told you, please send us a chat message and then we can go in more detail if necessary. So the agenda should everybody see in front of him. So introduction to DMT, purpose of test dust, application of test dust is the third part. Then characteristic properties of test dust we would like to present, then give you a short introduction how we produce the test dust at DMT, then some slides above the quality control, and especially some remarks to the safe handling of test dust, which is really very important for you, and a short introduction to our webshop, if somebody doesn't know this webshop till now. Okay, Knut, please, the next slide. This is the presentation, what is DMT? So DMT today is a company which belongs to the TÜV Nord. Nevertheless, it was founded in the Ruhr area near or in the town Essen quite long ago. So the roots were in the mining business, and it was founded in 1737. So it's a quite old company. DMT is not the abbreviation, as you could ask for Das Manufacturing Technology. The predecessor organizations were renamed to Deutsche Montantechnologie in 1999, so 22 years before. And then DMT was named DMT 2006 when it was sold from the former RAG to the TÜV Nord Group. Today we have four main business areas. Exploration still today means raw material exploration, engineering, including our branch where we work, which is named inspection and product testing, then consulting and geotechnologies. And DMT has today roughly 900 employees. It's located the headquarter at the A40, the motorway A40 in Essen. So the next slide, please.
Yeah.
We started in our department, Das Manufacturing, for our own supply long time ago, because in the former time when we were still part of the support of the German mining, underground mining industry, we were more or less responsible for the deduster testing for underground applications or underground dedusting in the mines. And for that purpose, we were using a lot of test dust, and therefore we started with the production of test dust and use it for the dusting system testing. Afterwards, we got the basic technology. We were then part of the development, or we developed for the vacuum cleaner industry, the special synthetic household test dust, which we still today name DMT type 8, and which is sold as type 8 test dust for vacuum cleaner testing. And by this, we were then starting test dust production as own business, and it was strongly increased, this business, especially by the need of the vacuum cleaner industry for the eco label roughly 10 years ago. And today, as we told in the introduction, we have more than 50 different types of test dust in our portfolio. Nevertheless, DMT type 8 is more or less still the most important one.
And reference materials are usually monodispersal spherical particles, as you can see in this electron microscope picture of these. They all have the same shape and exactly the same size, and due to that, they are mostly used for validating of measurement methods and or for calibration of measurements. These particles are certified, and due to that, not just because they are certified, because to the fact that they are quite difficult to produce, they get really expensive. That is the way is the most difference to test us. If I go another slide back, these fractured materials are way more easier to produce. And in this case, it's not about any particle, it's about the entire bulk. So the average of this bulk is supposed to fit into the behavior of the dust.
or particle size distribution.
Particle size distribution.
Standard, which is often the route we follow, that we have to produce a test dust with a standardized particle size distribution.
So, back to this slide. Test dust as a translation from a natural known dust, like household dust, which can be seen right here on the left, and they are translated into an average into average values, and these average values can be produced again and again with continuous quality, like this household test dust we offer. They are qualified and useful for repeatable testing, and due to that, they have laboratory quality standards, and as I mentioned before, they represent an average of natural dust. In this case, it's household dust, as one can see in this picture, but sometimes even of airborne particles in environmental or in landscapes. And due to the fact that these artificial dusts want to aim on the properties of the natural dust, they use similar materials like in natural dust to obtain the same rheology of the dust, but they are not exactly the same, because in natural dust there are usually way more different materials than one can or than can be found in artificial test dusts. They aim on imitation of defined measurable parameters, and way more important, they aim on the fact that these parameters come with the dust in a repeatable quality. They use affordable components, so these dusts are way cheaper than a reference material, but as one can imagine, way much more expensive than the household dust you can find in your vacuum cleaner at home, due to the fact most of us just put it in the trash and don't try to purchase it to others. So what are they mainly used for, these testers? First of all, of course, filter performance testings with dust, but also with aerosols. In this case, there are no dusts used, but these aerosols are supposed to stand for dust with quite a little particle size distribution. And I guess that's the most obvious purpose of testers, as one can see with such a big deduster, where a lot of dust gets sprayed in and gets hopefully cleaned out of the airstream. And due to these measurements, the separation efficiency and even the energetic efficiency of dedusters or of vacuum cleaner bags can be given on a measurable scale, like for example clogging in these vacuum cleaner bags. But there are also environmental testings, like you can see down here with dust proof of machines, or even these. Okay, this one is not. I got a background filter, so no one can see it. A lot of you will maybe know these construction site cell phones, which are mostly dust proof, and that also has to be in at a continuous standard. And there's also abrasive simulation, like for example in hydraulic oil systems, and if some dust gets into these hydraulic oil components, which gets over the lifetime of for example construction machines, then these abrasive influence onto the machines and valves need to be supervised before they get onto the market. But there are also some special tests. For example, one can see right here in the middle picture, floor cleaning on a hardwood floor, headlight cleaning for cars, or contamination of critical manufacturing sites, like for example the cigarette machine or the lemonade machine, where we also offer a coin dust to simulate the aggressive part of the coins bought into these lemonade machines over the lifetime. So, first of all, right now we come to the characteristic properties of dust. And first of all, there are particle properties, the kind of material, so which material is used, the particle size and size distribution, because usually most dusts are not monodispersal. They all have mostly slightly different particle size, the particle shape and shape distribution. One can say how far is it away from a perfect spherical shape, the surface roughness and material hardness, the material density and the inner surface. All these properties come to are taken all together, and they result in the properties of the continuum or the bulk. With the surface energy of the entire bulk, some adhesive forces not just to surfaces next to the dust, but also to the particles under each other, the bulk density, and the bulk flow behavior of dusts. So the application of test dusts, once again, first of all, or that's quite important to us to mention it right here, the preparation of test dust before application by the end user, mechanical stressing or mixing, like one can see with such a tumbling mixer, because almost every test dust gets transported by a truck, and well, most of us will know segregation, and maybe since working with dust or with filtration, but we also know segregation back in the days when we were little children, like we had with these muesli, when your bigger sister got the tasty sweet chocolate parts, and there was the other parts was given for the younger sisters or brothers. So acclimatization of dust is quite also an important, and climate control of ambient air is quite important to the behavior of the dust due to the fact if these dusts come from a quite cold area, they may be transported in buckets without any air exchange to the outside, but the material is quite cold. And due to the fact that the material is quite cold, and almost every climate-controlled ambient air has humidity, cold particles in humid air will bring immediate evaporation. And in this case, this evaporation brings capillary bridges of the water in between, and then there are formed these little particles to such bigger ones. And that is what's brought afterwards into the measurement, but not these little particles. So it's quite important to acclimatize the dust before using it. And of course, if it's needed, a correct dispersion of the test dust. But that's usually defined by each and every test standard. So the production of test dust. The materials, there are normative declarations and non-normative declarations to substitute hazardous ingredients. One can imagine if there's a dust with quite little particle size distribution and it's completely made of silica, that's quite hazardous to the user. So if it's not about the hardness of the material, but just the particle size distribution, more and more users go to substitute the silica-based dusts with, for example, dolomite dusts to avoid any harms to the stuff. And the preparations of most of all materials in a test dust are the most common ways of mechanical engineering, like sieving, dry and wet. The wet variation, the wet one is mostly used for really little particles or really little sieves, wind sifting, cutting of, for example, cotton, milling, spheronizing to get a less fractional particle shape, blending of different materials and different material size distributions, and afterwards, of course, mixing. And there's also my favorite example for destructive and constructive granulation. If you have a look on such a little cookie, then one can do some destructive granulation. And if these particle sizes are the ones that are mostly liked for eating the cookies, these bigger parts can be taken back into granulation to make littler particles. But these really little particles, which always occur when at constructive granulation, on destructive granulation, could be brought back and pressed into such a briquette again, but mostly they are not. And a lot of materials are not, for a lot of materials, it's not possible to do some constructive granulation with common methods. So there's always a waste stream in test dust production. After production of a test dust, there always is a quality control, not just after the production, even before, for the raw materials. And there are no normative quality control. There's a normative quality control, which first of all gives control of test dust properties like the particle size and particle size distribution, the materials which are contained in the dust, the shape, and sometimes even the pressure drop. And some standards even say which methods are supposed to be used: sieving, impaction of airborne particles, laser diffraction, wet or dry dispersed. You can see right here an example of an A2 fine dust, which could be sieved, but nowadays it's way more comfortable to bring this bulk dispersed in water, which gets penetrated by laser light, and these laser light comes to a diffraction, which is taken into evaluation on a numerical way by a computer, and gives afterwards a particle size distribution. So to make it short, putting in the dust, hit the play button, and be happy for the results after a few seconds. And we also have a Stokes sink rate for several for several dusts, not a lot, but they still, but there are still a few examples for it. Light microscopy, sorry for that. That's mostly used for fiber length distribution, and helium pycnometry for material density. But there's we perform also non-normative quality controls, additionally or most additionally to normative testing. Normative standards may have tolerances. If they have tolerances, it's absolutely fine, and I'm quite glad about it. But in some cases, they even leave too big ways for interpretation, especially for military standards. They sometimes say, okay, we need a dust which with all particles may not be bigger than 850 microns. Well, what could I do with it? I could use a nanomaterial, or I could even use a sand, which you can find in a playground. But these two different dusts would bring absolutely different results in testing. So we even do some non-normative additional testing to all of our dusts to ensure the highest con and or to ensure a continuous quality of our dust. So one can buy even a military standard right now, and if it's bought in 2025, it will have the same the same properties as that one which is bought right now. So right here is the quality control, once again on an example of the test dust type air, our simulated household test dust. First of all, of course, characterization of the received raw materials. Then every needed fraction is produced by with the different materials, different shapes, different particle sizes, and even with different methods for that. One can imagine cotton fibers are cutted, and dolomite part gets milled, and afterwards, when the particle size distribution is correct, all these different fractions get blended in a mixer. You can see it right here on the on this picture. Oh, first of all, these fractions are characterized, of course, and then mixed. The mixing time needs to be constant. The mixing machine also should be the same one. In our case, it's quite easy because we have six mixing machines in a row, and we can we always use these six and do not change them in between. And it's quite important to keep up the same filling level of these drums, because if the level is a bit lower in these drums, then effect can be observed. This drum starts rotating, and these fractional particle part has a higher higher fall height, and due to that, it has a higher impact to penetrate the fiber part, and then different results of pressure drop can be obtained. So we always keep it at a continuous level, and to ensure a continuous quality of our product. The in this case, the pressure drop is defined in the standard, which always gets obtained, but we also do additional some microscopic analysis of the fiber length of the cut cotton, which is from our side quite important to keep it on a constant level. Safe handling of oh, Dirk, wolltest du die vorher machen oder sonst übernehme ich die gerne? Du bist noch gemutet.
So, just to make a small change, I will continue for the self-handling part. Because you see usually only the coarse dust fraction, which is entering the air. When you handle with the test dust, it's really important that you are clear about what may happen if you work with silica-based, especially silica-based test dust. And as we told in the beginning, DMT was coming from the mining, underground mining branch in the Ruhr area. And from that time, there's a lot of information and experience with the harmful side of dusts, because by underground mining with the hard coal, always parts of quartz were released in the air, and it was took quite a long time that it was remarked that it was the reason for the silicosis of the coal workers. And therefore, in the time after the Second World War, the regulations of the silica dust and the underground mines were getting stricter. And at least, especially in the German underground mining, there were no cases for the workers in the underground mines of silicosis in the last 20 years. So this was a very effective work to take precautions by different means to avoid this silica dust in the underground mining. Today, we know that especially the smaller particles are more harmful than the bigger ones, but the smaller ones you often don't see. And therefore, especially if you work with small amounts of test dust, you should not be so sure about the safe, that you work safe. Please always keep in mind that if possible, you should enclose your process so that dust does not escape. You should have sucking machines as far as possible to extract the dust emissions near the source where you work with the dust. And last but not least, you should always wear protective equipment, especially respirator masks, as the well-known FFP2 mask, which now everybody has at home, to really work safe. Here you see a link, at least, but you find it in Germany at the Bauer, and there are several sources where you can find more information how to care about or how you can protect yourself against dust. And therefore, please do it, because as we see in our facility, when you work regularly with dust, sometimes you forget it to take these precautions. Okay, Jens, please take over again.
So the another little service we also offer is determination of dustiness of powders in our laboratory, and they are divorced into three different fractions: inhalable, thoracic, and respirable. In this case, they are just airborne particles characterized. So there are different methods. We perform those or two of these with a rotating drum, the 15051/2 and the 5599/2/1. And this one is more for nanomaterials. And there's also a free fall tower, which where particles are characterized by diffraction after impacting the ground. But the evaluation or the knowledge about the dustiness of powders and bulks is quite important to almost everyone who works on a daily basis with powders. And in this case, there are these rotating drums of different sizes with powder inside, and where the powder gets dispersed in an air current through it, and then characterized afterwards on filters. And we even do some modification. We perform it with a seventh stage impactor to get a higher resolution of these dusts. But please keep in mind, dusts may be quite harmful to humans. We also want to do some commercial for our testers webshop. It's not just to simplify the purchase of testers at DMT. You can see the link right here on the slide. It's also, well, just to be honest, in 2021, I guess almost everyone does online shopping nowadays, and you have the possibility to purchase our dusts right here. But I know it from different companies, they do not accept webshops. But if your company does not accept ordering in a webshop, that's no problem. we also take orders on the old-fashioned way, but this webshop contains quite a lot of informations for the particle size distributions, for the materials which are contained in the dusts, and for logged in users, even the prices and the shipping prices. Due to the fact we are the first webshop for test dusts, all of us are quite glad to get some feedback what we can improve on this webshop. So feel free to give some feedback after visiting this site. Even if you don't order something, you just miss any informations, just let us know. I'm not supposed to do some commercials for other companies, but let's formulate it different. I'm not supposed to say we are the Amazon of testers, and we are quite proud about it. So thank you for your attention. I hope there are any questions from your side.
Yeah, great, Jens, Dirk, thank you for your interesting presentation, comments, notes, insights into the world of test dust. It was very interesting, and now it's the audience, now it's your chance to bring in your questions to the experts, and I will start with a question that I already well received, and start with a rather general one. Where can I see which properties of the natural dusts are imitated by the DMT test dusts?
Well, thank you for the question. I guess it's the most difficult question that could be asked. Most of the properties are defined in the standards within the dust. I'm not quite sure, or I guess we don't have it in our web shop. We just refer to the standards where all these properties are defined, and within these standards they also define why, or some of the standards define why these properties are taken, or how they are taken from the natural dust. If you have a look on the ISO 12103 for A2Fine, has even a little part of some sort of history lesson where one can see how it was produced back in the days of Dirk, correct me if I'm wrong. 1940. Yeah, sorry.
Yes, A2 yeah. Was
and later it was changed, but thanks for the feedback. I guess we should clarify it in our webshop also.
Yes, but I think for some testers it's quite easy, because if you use an environment test dust to test abrasive properties, you usually have test dust with a strong hardness. For purposes, if you want to test the tightness of housings, then you have mainly talcum as test dust, which was introduced quite long ago. And as it's often the case, if you have standards, some test dust even are used at times like today, when somebody does not know why they were introduced, that's sometimes the others think that testers in standards were introduced at times which sometimes are quite long ago.
Okay, thank you. We have another question there, same direction but more concrete to a specific application. It comes from Eleanor. She asked, we use fine mineral dust for testing within mechanical products. to check whether they will jam due to dust ingress over time. So fine mineral dusts are very aggressive for this and highlight problems easily. Are you aware of your dust being used for this? And do you have a recommendation as to which dusts are best for this purpose?
This is again something which where you have problems when you have abrasive test dust, and especially very small abrasive test dust. And for environmental testing, we have in Europe several standards. There are, I think, some IEC standards too for environmental testing. And some of these are targeting these problems that you try to simulate the effect of using abrasive and quite small particles in an environment so that usually by a kind of Schnellalterung, progressive eldering process, you try to see effects which afterwards will take place in the real environment where these products are used. And I think this is something which you can then simulate under quite harsh conditions with such environmental testing standards. But if you have more detailed questions, which could be a good environmental standard, Eleanor, just send us an email and we can give you some examples for such environmental test standards.
Yeah, that's a great idea, Dirk. Eleanor, please put your email address into the chat. Only we can see it and we get back to you if we have more specific question on your specific requirements and on your test scenario.
Yes, and we can recommend some of our testers which are helpful for such environmental testing.
Great. Next questions. Are DMT's internal quality control procedures that go beyond the requirements of the standard published?
Yes.
So the question was if our internal quality standards are published, so everyone can see it. What was that?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. No. We do not publish our internal additional standards. That's something we do internally, absolutely, and we just guarantee the continuous quality on our dusts. So with every dust, there's always a referring standard with all purposes that are defined within the standard. And what we do internally additionally is completely internal. So it's not public for everyone.
And we have some official standards which have quite broad ranges for the test dust particle size distribution, for instance. And if we see that it's more helpful to have a continuously high or good quality, we then make internally some stricter internal specification and test so that we can then have a better quality than requested by the standard.
Okay, just give me another look into the chat.
And quality is something which we always try to improve, and especially in the communication with customers, we just have made several improvements in the last 10 years. And therefore, it's always helpful if we get a feedback from customer sides, if problems occur, that we can then check what we can do for improvements.
Yeah, and quality seems to be a big issue for the audience as well, because the next question is on audits. Have audits already been carried out at D&T in the area of test bus production, external audits from the client, maybe?
Yes, it's quite seldom. Nevertheless, we have had internal audits supplier audits from customers which we supply with test dust. And we have our test dust manufacturing process set up with the quality management system according ISO 9001. And we have in our filter testing laboratories most of the several procedures are accredited. We have an accredited test laboratory, and a lot of our instruments which we use for the test dust qualification are more or less comparable calibrated and controlled as our other test materials or testing analysis systems.
Yeah, so quality and quality assurance seems to be somehow the DNA of test dust production, provision, customer care, and so on. Understood. Thank you, Dirk.
Yes, you're welcome. Are there further questions?
I'm running through the chat window, so there's no question unanswered so far. And I'll just give the audience 10 seconds. Last question might come up. This does not seem to be the case. Okay, thank you, dear audience. Thank you, Dirk.
Thank you very much.
It was a pleasure for us to host this event. If you want to have a look on the other events at DMT provides to you, please have a look on our webpage. You'll find a dedicated webinar page with all of the upcoming webinars, but with almost every webinar that already has been performed. You can visit the videos there. Yeah, and that's it. Thank you and stay safe.
And have a good day. Bye-bye.
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 Oh, I see that we have a last question here. You are still there, Dirk and Jens? Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe we have some listeners. What? It's from Thorsten. What about the reuse of test dust, especially after testing, e.g. vacuum cleaning with a new dust bag? With HEPA technology, they are 99.98% filtered. Nearly all dust is bound inside the bag or filtration system. If we renew the system, we will only lose 0.02%. The loss is not highly necessary, test acceptable. So reuse of test dust is a question on vacuum cleaning.
As everybody for us as a manufacturer of test dust, we all face emphasize not to reuse testers, that's clear. nevertheless, under such special conditions, it could work. So this is something which then as vacuum filter or vacuum bag manufacturer, I think everybody can test by itself. If the reuse testers will give comparable results. Nevertheless, especially if it's done in combination with a HEPA filtering system. Especially the small particle size fraction will, I think, will be reduced, and so the amount will decrease by reusing, and therefore at some point effects will occur, but this is something which we cannot predict, and therefore this must be tested if somebody want to do this. And I think it's worthwhile to make such a test and to check if this test does can be reused several times.
So we have a clear "it depends" answer here. Thorsten, if you are unsure, please get back to us and we will advise you on this special framework conditions. We have another question. Now it's from Stefan. We try to find small particles, 10 micrometer, on foils. It is difficult to put the test dust on the foil so that single particles are visible. Can you recommend a procedure how to put a very small amount of evenly distributed particles on a foil?
This is a problem which we sometimes have by ourselves when we want to make special tests with dust, and to get a homogeneously distribution across a foil, it's not easy to prepare. So what one can do is to have a place above the foil and to let it sedimentate, so to disperse it in the air and then to let it sedimentate, and to surround the foil by a casing so that no wind or air can deteriorate the sedimentation process. And by this it can be done, and there is no special system which I could recommend for such a procedure.
Okay. So that's really it. Thank you, Dirk. Thank you, Jens. Thank you, audience. Hope to meet with you soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Then.